All right, been meaning to do this for probably way too long. Answer some questions. It's Q&A time. Let's try to get through four. When do you record? And the questioner also had some snarky things to say about my attire. And it so happens that they are, they do coincide. The attire is what it is because I normally record prior to going to the gym or after I get back from the gym. I go to the gym every day, and that's when I tend to do it. So that's the reason that the attire is it's always a workout outfit. What podcast do you listen to? As you might expect, I'm a fan of podcasts, and I listen to a lot of podcasts. I jotted down the ones that I listen to with some regularity. There are others, and I will pay attention to the topic. I might pay attention to who's being interviewed. Freakonomics, the Freakonomics podcast, I will listen to nearly every episode. Stephen Dubner is the partner in crime with Steve Levitt. Steve Levitt is, are they both economists? I'm thinking that Steve Levitt is the economist and Stephen Dubner is kind of the writer of the two, but I could be wrong about that. It's a spectacular podcast. And if you haven't read the Freakonomics books, you must. And you should, I think you should listen to that. Andrew Warner at MixerG, MixerG.com. I'll put links in the show notes to this video. If you're watching this at YouTube, go over to the website, find this episode. I'll put a link to that at the YouTube channel. But I'll put links to all this. Andrew Warner at MixerG is, in my opinion, is hands down the best interview format out there. Probably because, well, for two reasons. One, he has on good guests. Number two, he does three reasons. He does his research. He does his homework. He does his preparation. And number three, he doesn't throw softball questions. He digs deep. I'll add a fourth. He doesn't talk too much. There are some people that are out there that do interviews, and I have a really difficult time listening because they can't shut up. Or I'm thinking of a female, and it's just she laughs at every answer, and she's way too giggly for me. But Andrew Warner does a great job. Marcus Sheraton, the sales lion. Marcus is primarily a blogger, but he has begun doing some little short, they're Q&A kinds of audio recordings that do a podcast. And I read his blog and I listen to his podcast. Marcus is an inbound marketing expert. He got on my radar a few years ago because the company that I was running at the time, I was talking to the folks over at HubSpot. I was considering a move to Hub. In fact, before I retired and resigned that position, I did go to HubSpot. And so that's where he came on my radar. He has since that time, he has sort of blown up in a good way, and Marcus is a real likable guy, and it's a very interesting story. But Marcus Sheraton, the sales lion, the guys at Marketing Over Coffee, I've been listening to for a long, long time. Christopher Penn, C.S. Penn, and John Wall. Christopher Penn, if memory serves right, Christopher Penn and Chris Brogan may have originated the first PodCamp. both up in the Boston area. I'll have to research that. I think I've got that right, but I've been a longtime reader of C.S. Penn and been on his email list for a good long while. I listen to that podcast regularly. I will freely admit there are a number of times that they'll have discussion that it's over my head and really beyond my interest as far as some of the technical stuff, but they're two very, very bright guys, and I find the conversation interesting. And anyway, so there's that. Marketing over coffee. Mike Russell, this is a new guy who's come on the scene. There's another person who I listen to who's based here in Dallas. He's a radio imaging guy named Ryan Drean, D-R-E-A-N. And Ryan will have voiceover people. He'll have radio imaging kind of people. I'm not in that space, but it's interesting to me. What can I say? I'm a big enough hardware geek, microphones, processors, and that workflow and that space. I find that space very intriguing. I've never aspired to be in that space. It's just I find it interesting. Mike Russell is a UK radio imaging guy who came on the scene of podcasting, and Music Radio Creative is his podcast, and they're just extraordinarily well done. They're obviously well produced. That's the business he's in. They're not overproduced. And in fact, if anything, I've emailed him a time or two, and he's been kind enough to email back and forth. And you know, I told him, I mean, there's nothing that says these things have got to be under 15 minutes. You can go longer. His podcasts are very, very short. Can't fault him for that. The guys over at Internet Business Mastery, man, I have listened to these guys forever. Just seems like forever. I don't even know when they started, but I have a hard time remembering a time not listening. I don't think I know that they don't go by Jay and Sterling now, but old habits hard to break. Jason Van Orden, and Jason Van Orden was, you know, he was one of the original podcast guys, wrote a book, that I'm sure is long out of print now about podcasting and migrated and morphed into the internet marketing space. And even though I have somewhat lambasted that space, I listen to them. I find them easy to listen to and valuable. It's where I first heard the name Pat Flynn. Pat Flynn had been a member of their academy, and he came on a show where they were introducing, you know, success stories. They were using people that were part of their group, their paid group, their Internet Business Mastery Academy. And Pat Flynn was a guy who'd been an architect and got laid off, and he had been studying for the LEADS exam, which is like a green kind of an exam based on what little I remember. And he had thrown his notes up online so he could study. He could access them by the internet. And figured out, you know, he could sell that. He could make some money and blew up in a really good way, began making not only money, but began making more money than he was making at his old job. And, of course, he has since gone on to rock star fame, because then he morphed that into the internet marketing space as well. And his podcast, you know, took off. I listened to his, and with pretty good regularity. I'm not in that space. I often find it interesting and entertaining. And he too is a very likable guy. That's one thing that all these people have in common, at least for me. Yeah, they're likable. They're likable. They're entertaining. They're informative. Most are all of the above. Michael Hyatt, of course, you know, is a rock star. And I subscribe to all these. I'm not going to tell you that I listen to every episode. I don't. Some of them I do, but not all of them. Michael Hyatt is one of those. I subscribe. I download every episode into iTunes. I may or may not give it a listen. Cliff Ravenscraft, podcast answer man. Cliff is a little bit like the Internet Business Mastery guys. I can't remember not listening to him. I got on my radar fairly quickly for obvious reasons. I mean, at the time, the genius was the URL. I mean, the genius was the branding. The genius was Podcast Answer Man. I mean, come on, it just doesn't get much better than that. I was not a Lost TV watcher, so I knew that he blew up a little bit in that genre. I don't remember how I found him. I did listen to him before he quit his insurance gig, so it goes back that far. And so there, Podcast Answer Man. There are many, many others, but that gives you some sense of it. My tastes are everything from, you know, kind of technical, geeky things to a lot of business things, a lot of marketing things. So there, those are the podcasts that I listen to. I listen to podcasts every day because I go work out every day and I load them up on that aqua colored iPod shuffle. And, so there you have it. Occasionally, if I'm doing, depends on the kind of work I'm doing. If I'm working on a website or something, yeah, I'll slap the headphones on and I'll launch iTunes and I might listen, but most of it is done at the gym. Where am I at? Third question. How many books do you read? And I get a number of questions about this and books and what are you reading and what do you read? And so, the last book that I read, was by Jeff Goins, Wrecked. It has a catchy subtitle that's pretty powerful, but it escapes me, but Wrecked by Jeff Goins. And then I downloaded the audio and I listened because, you know, he read the audio. If an author can do his own book narration, and they can't all do that because some of these guys, they're far better in text than they are listening to them. But Jeff's audio book, well done. And, so yeah, that Wrecked by Jeff Goins. I am trying to do, and I've said this before, I think out on a podcast or in a video somewhere, I'm really working to try to wrestle a book at a time. It's a lifelong habit of juggling too many books, reading on average 6 books at a time. I don't know if it's an attention span thing. I don't know. But it's a habit for sure. And I'm having a real difficult time breaking that habit, I'll have you know. Reading a few chapters, reading a few minutes out of one, putting it down, picking up another one. Don't ask me. I've never done that with fiction, oddly enough. But I've done that for as long as I can remember with nonfiction books. And I'm trying desperately to break that habit. So, but if you don't read, I would encourage you to read. The Kindle, I love, and I occasionally get questions about, you know, do I prefer, because, well, hello, look behind me, because of all the books, you know, and how do I feel about the Kindle? Well, a friend of mine gifted me a very generous gift out of the blue. She sent me a Kindle some years ago. And, of course, there's tons of things to love about it, not the least of which is you can carry umpteen books in a package very thin and portable. And so that's great. The battery life is great. You can send PDFs to yourself, and that's great. So it's got some huge pluses. I miss paper. I miss the physicality of, I don't know. My wife and I were talking about houses that have libraries and, you know, and how that's, we don't, my whole house is a library. The whole studio is a library, but you know, there are some big dog homes that have libraries. Well, okay. What's going to happen with those? I mean, it's, you know, there's going to be a couple of electronic devices on the wall and the shelves bare. You know, I don't know. I don't know what's going to happen with books, but if I had my way, I would, that's not technology that I would, you know, I appreciate it, but I kind of wish it didn't exist. And for a geeky guy that can be kind of a gearhead, that's really odd, but I like holding a book. And there's something also to a past and a present. Years and years ago, I read a book called Time Wars. Jeremy Rifkin wrote this book. I really enjoyed this book, and I've picked it up way too many times, threatening to reread it. I have not. This is an old book. Probably is out of print. But I remember reading in this book something that stayed with me, and I have used this. If you look at a digital, the difference between digital and analog, the point that he made is with an analog watch, an analog face watch that has a minute hand, an hour hand, and a second hand, there is this element of past, present, and future. You can see on the face of that watch what once was, and you can see what will be, and you can see the current time. Digital, you don't. Digital is just present. Present. The present. Now, the book was written back, as I recall, I don't remember there being LCD watches. They were LED. They had red LEDs, and you had to push a button to get the time to show up. But the same principle is true still. It's just the present. The present. And no concept of past or future. And I get that same sense with a book. With a physical book, you can be 100 pages in and you see what you've read. You see, yeah, I've read that much, and there's progress, you know? And then you see, well, I've got that much to go. And so you've got this concept of past, and you've got this concept of the future, and you have this concept of, well, I'm on this page right now. I'm on page 101 or whatever. I like physical books. Okay, the last question, and then we'll wind this up. What's a typical day? I don't have a typical day. I really don't. I used to have typical days. For the better part of my entire career, I had typical days as far as, you know, getting up at a certain time, going to work at a certain time, getting off more or less at a certain time, not always. And now that I am in this, I'd call it semi-retired mode. Well, let me just address it this way, because people do ask. I'm 55, and I walked away from a lifelong career. I'm a debt-free citizen. You know, there are things that I can do. There are things that I can't do. I'm not independently wealthy in the sense that I can't just, you know, go frivolously spend money and do whatever I want. But I live a fairly simple life, and there's not many things that that I want. There aren't many things that I lack for. And I'm really able to kind of call my own shots. I spend a little bit of time with this. Not that much. I just do it consistently. So for me, the last couple of years, boy, there really is no typical day. I've got grandkids, and the grandkids may show up out of the blue a few mornings a week. Primarily my wife, you know, has the grandsons, and you know, it's that kind of stuff. If you're not at a place in your life yet, I hope you can get to that place. There are a lot of things about it that are very cool. My wife and I obviously are at this age. We are empty nesters, but man, it's never been so empty that it was this full. because your family expands. You know, those of us that are blessed with kids and those of us that are blessed with grown kids who live by us and who have kids of their own, the herd gets bigger. The herd isn't here all the time, but they're here enough, and that's a good thing. That's a very, very good thing. So the good news is there really is no typical day. And that's a pretty good place to be. Not everybody can be there, and I understand that because I've lived the bulk of my life not being there. It's just been within recent years that I've been able to be there. So that's that. Hey, let me tease something, because this has some bearing for what the next show is going to be about, especially that number in that kind of red guitar pick shape space there, that number 50. Yeah, for those of us that are follically impaired, we have to, well, it's smart. It's smart for us to wear sunscreen protection. Yeah, so stay tuned. We'll talk about some of this stuff next time. My name is Randy Cantrell. The website is bulanetwork.com. Thank you for asking the questions. Feel free to email me, others, all kinds of ways to reach me. This is the Yellow Studio.